Okay, one last reminder. Phone's on silent, and let's get into it. Welcome, Santiago. There we go. This is BUDx Santiago. This is a thing we've been doing around the world. We've done India, we've done Korea. It's a mix of talks, panels, discussions, workshops, and obviously we're going to have a party after. So we're kicking off with a very, very special guest, a guy who's kind of really hard to introduce just because he's done so much. A guy who's been making songs, not songs, he's been making hits since the 90s. He's obviously collaborated with people like Todd Terry, Little Lou Vega, obviously Masters at Work, remixed tons of artists from, you know, underground right to the biggest artists you could ever think of, done stuff, I don't know, house, hip-hop, even with New Recon Soul, done like funk, jazz, broken beats, salsa. Obviously, South America's in the house, so. And with this, we're going to kind of have a talk with him about how he made those, but more actually what he produces now, so the people who maybe produce watching online can see how he works, what he does, and basically how you make your tracks.
Yeah, well, you want to start from the beginning?
Yeah, let's start with the classic era what you were using back then.
First and foremost, what's up, Chili? What's up? All right. Yeah. So, from the beginning, you know, I learned from Todd Terry in 1988. You know, he had a drum machine, an SP-1200 drum machine. And I saw that machine and I was just like, wow, like, you know, I can make beats with that, you know what I mean? And slowly, I learned the machine, and in 1989, I was already doing records, and I met Louis Vega. And how that happened was I did a record called A Touch of Salsa, and, you know, Louis wanted to remix this record, and, you know, it never happened. But he invited me to the studio. He was working on Mark Anthony's album, and that's pretty much the rest is history. You know what I mean? That was the birth of Masters at Work in the studio, working on Mark Anthony, India, and so on and so forth.
And what were you using back then? Did you just
the MU SP-1200 and the S950? Those were the machines.
And then how did it work with having those machines presumably in your house, and then the collaboration process?
Well, the process was, you know, every day. You know, I was going to the studio, and every morning, me and Louis spoke on the phone, and we talked about concepts and ideas of what the rhythm was gonna be like, and I created those beats at my house, and then went to the studio and recorded them.
And he would jam over?
Yeah, and then we would take it a step further. He would add the bass and the keyboards and all that kind of stuff. If there was if it was a vocal, we would sample the vocals and chop them up, and that's how the whole Masters at Work dub was created.
And this was throughout maybe the 90s era, then?
Yeah, all the way to 2000.
And then how did it progress? Because, like, obviously you started working more with musicians, and how did the gear, like, was it basically that same structure for?
Well, what happened was, you know, as we went on, we got kind of bored with certain instruments and stuff, so we wanted to incorporate different vibes. So we started bringing in percussionists and horn players and guitarists, and, you know, it just kept going. And then we started hitting the genres. We touched the Latin, and then we touched Afro, and then jazz and Latin. So we just kept evolving.
Spawned Broken Beat, really.
And Broken Beat, that's a whole nother story. But as time went on, the machines went on as well, too. Because at that same time, you know, I was using the Kai MPC 3000.
Shout out to Akai, by the way. They gave us an MPC X within 24 hours notice. So shout out to those guys.
This machine came here in 24 hours. You know, it's pretty crazy. So yeah, we got to thank them for that. But pretty much what this machine is reminiscent of what that 3000 was, but in today's mindset, you know, you're able to use it with a computer. You're able to use it on standalone. But my mentality as a producer has never changed. I completely compose the same way I did when I was 18 years old. You know what I mean? I approach, whether it's hip hop, I approach it the same. Whether it's house, I approach it the same. Obviously, if I'm working with musicians, it's a different thing. But for me, with the machine, it's the same approach, pretty much.
Just for the gearheads, we've obviously got something that we can do here quickly for you guys. But what's your setup at home? Do you have, like, tons of machines, or is
man,
it a fairly
it's,
stripped
it's
back?
Crazy at home. It's crazy. There's about
give the
80 synthesizers. Pretty much every drum machine from 83 up, every one. Because, you know, I'm a student of sound, so pretty much every record that I loved or played as a DJ, I wanted to have those sounds, the original sounds. So I used those machines throughout my career, you know, and it's 28 years that I've been doing this.
Do you still use them, or are you mainly going software now?
Nah, I sampled most of them already. You know, I have all the sounds in you know, in the computer and stuff.
I've also read that you've got 50,000 records.
It's grown since that. Oh. That was probably 5 years ago.
Have you got any room in your apartment?
there's records in my place. All the important stuff is at my house. And then there's records in storage, there's records in the studio, there's records in the garage. You know. Unfortunately, like, I wanted to go shopping here because I know there's some crazy music, but I'm not going to be able to go this time.
So maybe bring him some gifts, give him some vinyl. So with this particular masterclass, we're going to break down some beats.
Yeah.
If we've got time, just because of the different styles that you've done right over your career. But I think the plan, if we can get through it, is we maybe start with a hip-hop one.
Yep.
And if we've got time, we'll
do
a house one.
So basically, I was in my studio. I'm working with an MC named Rashid Chappelle. We're actually working on our second album right now.
This is on your own label, right?
Yeah, this is on KD Records. And I'm in the studio, and I'm doing this. I'm just hitting pads, you know what I mean? Right? So he comes in, he says, yo, make a beat. And I'm like, so that was one pattern, you know what I'm saying? So I was like, all right, well, you know, let's keep building on that. So pretty much what I want to do is I want to play you the beat.
Is this the finished one, you mean?
Well, nah, this is not the finished. I'm going to play you the beat, and then we'll go to the finished song.
Right.
You know what I mean? So I'm gonna go through the patterns, and this is what I love about this machine. The way I used to make beats back in the days, you could make your sequences and you could change them on the fly. So I would do this. You know what I mean? And I would just kind of do that stuff. You know what I mean? So that's the beauty of the MPC.
And the drums, the
drums are coming out of here too.
The record, where are you getting the samples from?
You want me to disclose samples?
I mean, I don't want you to get in.
That's like hip hop rule number one, right? We're on Boiler Room. He's like, what's the sample? I'm like, what?
I thought, man, are you sampling from vinyl? I wasn't trying to hot you up.
Yes, you was. He's like, what's the sample? He's reading the sample too, right?
Got
it says Polish Jazz something. So there you go. It's a Polish record, pretty much, from Poland. But I'm not telling you what it is.
And he's still sampling
from
vinyl.
It's a Polish jazz record, too.
He's still sampling from vinyl.
Absolutely.
No MP3s, no YouTube.
No MP3s. The reason for not sampling MP3s, and for all the producers and beat makers out there, is when it comes time to actually do your mix down, you have nothing to grab because the MP3 is this big, right? And a wave is this big. You know what I mean? So you have all the sound on a wave or AIFF, and an MP3 is just a compressed version of that. You know what I mean? So don't sample off of SoundCloud. Don't sample off of YouTube, which a lot of people do. Obviously, if that's the only way, if that's your only source of sampling, so be it. But, you know, find the original record. You know why? Because chances are you're gonna find other stuff on that record.
You still digging a lot then?
Yeah, I just told you, I wanted to go shopping here.
Right, so let's...
Nah, it never stops. You know, with music, the beautiful thing about music, you'll always find something you've never heard. There's just so much music recorded that it's a constant learning process. You know, for somebody to say, oh, I got everything, it's impossible. You know, there's a lot of us that do this hardcore, and we don't have everything. It's just every day you learn about a different record, different artists, you know, different instrument, you know what I mean, so.
What have you found more, I guess, fulfilling or satisfying? Is it working with musicians and that sort of collaboration process, or is it just you, a stack of wax, and just laying
it's
it down?
It's a little bit of everything, you know what I mean? You know, when you find those records that make you go like, wow, I wish I made that song, then that happens. But musicians also take things in a whole different place, you know what I'm saying? And I've been real fortunate to work with some incredible ones.
Could we get into this track a bit more and the chops?
Yeah,
so
pretty much, you know, like I said before, Rashid Chappelle walks in the studio. I laid down the beat. He wrote to it on the spot. Mind you, this record probably happened in about 45 minutes, you know, because by the time I laid down the beat, he already had wrote his verse, and here it is.
Yo, Sugar Hill, yeah.
My fault. We muted the vocals because of this guy before. So it's all his fault. Here we go.
Sugar Hill, yeah. I was born with a foot in the grave, that's all my name. The shame that hangs over me is carried by the younger me. Mama high, my daddy high, you know the story. I won't bore you, introduction is formal. Seem normal, chaos was cordial. You getting money, the whole hood applaud you. Pussy won't ignore you, the man in the town. Till the next king ride, take your head for the crown. Shots around liquor, shots around niggas. Siren sings like a chorus, live around niggas. So it's death and so we step on eggshells. Crack mouths, syringe needles and lead shells. Silver lining is just clouds above us. Cement slabs, ceilings and smoke clouds above us. I give you life, no ad-libs or hype men. It's ice thin, the road out, there's no signs. Roam blind, hands open, we reaching out. But no hope, no jokes, there's no smiles. Hard here, there's no signs of God here. Lot of churches, perverse what we worship. Auction at the altar, souls up for purchase.
The highest bidder either sell or a casket. Willie Lynch tactics for years has been practiced. With no conscience, dividing and conquer. They label us a savage when they the real monsters.
And I'm still with a foot in the grave until my name called. Arm laid sprawl, cold in the street. Just the life of a martyr that was chosen to speak. Just the life of a slave that'd die to be free.
Yeah, thank you.
Is every sound from there taken from the same sample? Like there was little horn stabs.
Here he goes again with the sample.
I'm not asking you to disclose the sample.
Here he goes. He's trying. You're like, you know what I mean? Nah, yeah. Pretty much it's different parts of the record, yeah, for the changes and stuff. But like I said, I'm going through it. There's a horn part. That's the main line. And then this is the change. saying?
And what are you using to chop that up? Is it?
It's all in here. So if we go to sample edit, there's a sample. He gets to hear, see the real, those are all the pieces right there. That's the whole shit right there. And pardon me.
And then when you take your chops, you put your drums on it, you taking the bass line from filtering of the sample, or are you playing on top of it? Or
actually, you know what? I didn't even get to that part yet of the record. I haven't done that yet. I haven't added bass to it yet.
Oh, really?
That's just the piano just EQ'd, like, real strong.
Right.
Yeah.
It kind of booms.
So, like right here, like, I can show you real quick. You see that? And that's another part. And that's the vocals right there. My little secret stuff.
And that's just taking the, just basically
yeah,
focusing
that's just,
on the
you know,
low end.
And again, that goes back to when I was a kid. You know, we didn't have filters. We didn't have that. So, you know, you had to EQ your sample a certain way in layers to create the bass line. Because we wasn't musicians, so we wasn't playing the bass line. So we had to make the bass line out of the sample, get the middle part, and then get the highs. Yeah. But now, you know, all that stuff is in this machine. Filters, delays, reverbs, all kinds of stuff is in this machine now. You know what I mean? Which is really dope where you could just zone into this box.
Do you always start with a sample when you make it?
It depends. You know, sometimes you hear a rhythm in your head and, you know, you make the beat first, and then sometimes you start with the sample, you know? So it changes every time.
And do you play much stuff over the top?
Depends. It depends, yeah. Sometimes we add guitarist over the top, fuzz guitar, because if sometimes, like, the sample is low, so the instruments, you could only EQ but so much. So sometimes you enhance those sections with instruments on top, you know, bass line and guitars or string lines or horns, more horns. Sometimes I kind of redo the whole sample.
You replay it?
Just get it replayed by musicians.
Right.
Then I got more power to, you know, level everything out the way it's supposed to be, the way I hear it.
Just get it cleaner.
Yeah, no doubt.
Right, should we, do you want to break down this more, or should we go into the house track that you had lined up?
Want to just move on? Yeah, hold on a second.
So where do you sequence in? Is it in the machine, or do you do it in?
Sequence it in the machine. Where we going right here? I can't see.
So what is this program? This is just that comes with the MPCX.
I'm sorry.
What is this program?
This is the version that's in the computer. Let me just do this shit here. Browser. What's crazy is this whole thing is like touchscreen.
Ooh, he's got like a whole bunch of stuff in here.
You know what I mean? obviously I can't find what I'm looking
Kenny
for.
Drums 2018.
I can't find what I'm. Oh, right here. Oh no.
And do you just have like banks of drums that you've sampled over the years and just built up collections?
Yeah. It just, you know, it's crazy. Like at the house, like I said, you know, so many machines. I studied them. You sample them. You start. You know, one thing. Going back to the remixes. Every remix, you built the kit up. So each kit was new sounds, you know what I mean? So things add up fast, you know what I mean? And there's, you know, people have contacted me about doing sound libraries because there's so many sounds that have been used over the years, you know what I'm saying, with this stuff, so.
And you tempted to put out a sound library? You don't want to give it away?
I might do it. Okay, why can't, okay.
So what are you drawing for? Is this another unreleased joint?
Basically I was in Italy this weekend So I played this record. I don't know if you know it. It's called The Good Men. It was out in early, probably late 90s, early 2000s. Big percussion track. But I was like, you know what? I would like to make a beat out of that. You know, so let's mess around a little bit. Let's move this up. All right, so we got.
When you record, do you mean?
Let me just lower this a little bit. You gonna say something?
When you record, do you mainly tap it in like that, or do you draw it in?
Nah, I tap everything, because you know I've been playing with drum machines my whole life, you know what I mean? So I like doing it like that. And then we just keep adding to it. So then let's copy that sequence. Usually what I do is I just erase, and then I start adding from there. And again, make another sequence, copy, do it. Back, we erase, so now what's happening, you have different patterns. First one, second, third, let's add some more, different pattern. I don't like that. Testing. So then I might just go next set of sounds, right? So let's play again. And we keep building. I don't like that one, that last one. That's pretty much it. And you keep building. You know, it's like, thank you. Like, when I did those early Latin house records, like, you know, the Sumsai Say joint, the River Ocean, all that stuff was done like that.
Just like
just
session.
Pick sounds and just go, you know, track, pick a track, keep going. Then you kind of go back and start eliminating stuff and sequence it and all that. But that's the beauty of this, is you're able to have multiple tracks and you could just keep going and keep trying and keep going, you know?
Do you have any particular settings you use for the quantize and the swing?
Definitely. A lot of the 90s stuff was 16th triplets. That's straight 16 notes, straight, you know, there. Because it's just ready, it's just, you know, in that pocket. You know what I mean?
And the way you kind of jam that out, like, obviously that works for immediately that was quite a hard drum sounds. Do you approach it differently when you're doing something a bit more soulful or hip hop? Is it the same process?
Mentally, yes. And why I say that is, you know, I approach everything I do in that way. It just gets me amped up. You know what I'm saying? But I hear what you're saying, like a soulful record or whatever, you know, obviously the beat won't be like that hard. You know what I mean? That's some club, you know, crazy summer Ibiza stuff, you know what I mean? But yeah, everything is approached differently in a certain way, but still, you know, I like the sounds gritty. I like the drums, because I'm a hip hop head, so I like everything hitting hard, you know? That's why the more stuff had a sound, because, you know, I was coming with that hip hop raw sound, and then Louis was just adding all that other stuff to it.
More the Latin and
right, exactly. And that's yin and a yang.
That's kind of Todd Terry's approach as well. The hip hop philosophy behind.
Yeah, definitely. It's that Brooklyn stuff, man.
And then, is it just a jam session until you find like the four bar bit that you want, and you jam out multiple bits, throw away 95%.
Yeah, you know, you just keep like adding and taking away. You know what I'm saying? And then as you're building the track, you may hear different sounds, and then you look for those sounds or you play those sounds in. You know what I mean? And like I said, I'm a student of music. So I'm into so many different styles of records and sonics that I am automatically hear things, and I'm able to approach it. You know what I'm saying?
Is there any producers you really look up to or inspired, old or new, that you kind of you fucks with?
Man, there's so many. I'm into labels. Now, if we go back in time, you know, you had obviously Motown had a sound, Stax had a sound, you know, that was just different. You know, Memphis had High Records, which is another sound. You had Fania Records, which was a sound with a Latin music. You know, I'm into that. You know, just because those labels brought that out of those musicians. You know what I mean?
And had incredible rosters.
And it's hard for me to pick one producer, you know what I'm saying, or one artist, because I'm just so broad into music. You know what I mean?
It's funny that a lot of the labels you just mentioned are actually really old soul and really old, you know, like.
Yeah. Nah, but you know what? Not for nothing. My friends at Daptone, I don't know if you guys are into the soul stuff, but they revived that in Brooklyn. You know what I'm saying? And then my man Jazzy Jeff is reviving that in Delaware. You know what I mean? With his playlist retreat. You know, so that, you know, where he just gets a group of musicians in and they just jam. That, you know what I mean?
Like, that Dilla 1 hour jam session with
it's crazy. So we're trying to keep that going, you know what I mean? And that's something that is an idea, like for here, where you do these jam sessions in these countries. Because you don't know what's gonna happen. You know what I'm saying? So
local musicians, yeah.
So I'm giving you a concept right there. You know what I mean? So next time he comes out here,
Budweiser, that's on you. We'll make that
word
happen.
Word up. You got to make that happen. Nah, because realistically, there's a lot of talent in the room, so I'm curious to hear what's coming from here. You know, what you guys got. Same thing, when I go to South Africa, I want to hear what South Africans got. You know what I'm saying? And that's what it's about. And not for nothing, all the artists that, the labels and the artists that we spoke about, they traveled, so they got influences from all these countries. Went home and recorded, you know what I'm saying? So that's what fused this all, you know?
Yeah. Speaking of people within the room, have we got a microphone to open up some questions?
Born Strong is up there raising his hand.
So we've got that guy in the middle with the beard.
What's up?
Is it working? Can you hear me?
Yeah, I can hear you.
Hey.
What's up, man?
Hey, my name is Maciande. I'm a deep house producer.
What's up?
First of all, I would like to say thank you so much for coming to Chile. I would have never expected that you come. And
it was a long one, I tell you that.
Yes, yes. And yeah, that's for sure. And well, you've meant so much to me as an influence.
Man.
So I really appreciate what you've done. And well, I've got so many questions, but I would like to make two. The first one is, I would like to go through one of your latest records, which is Love for Days, a remix that you recently did. Because you were speaking just a few minutes ago that for some records you use a lot of sampling, and for some records you've actually recorded some instruments.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Mm-hmm.
So that's a record that, well, it's so well done, and that I can't tell if it's actually all sampled or you actually had some parts played. I would like to know about that.
No, it's played. There's stuff played in there, but I programmed all the beat, the drums, everything. And the approach was to make it sound like an old disco record, but now.
Certainly.
With the changes and the fills and all that kind of stuff, and then we followed it up with the music.
So, but the strings were actual strings, or were
this? Nah, keyboard strings, but they sound real, right?
Yeah, that was amazing.
Going back to what I was saying before, about learning textures, you know, it's very important that you guys learn textures if you want to produce that kind of stuff. You know what I mean?
Really, I'm sure it's got a lot of layers. And
yeah, that record took about 6 days to make.
Yeah.
Because every little piece we filled in, you know what I mean? Every little change, everything.
Yeah, so, well, yeah, congratulations on that record because
thank you, man.
You took it to the next level. And
that's what's up.
My other question is, I'm from Chile, right?
But okay.
I've been trying to collaborate with artists from all around the world. I'm currently trying to collaborate with Chadamir.
Okay.
But I'm kind of struggling with the idea of collaborating remotely,
mm-hmm.
right? And I would like to know if you have any experience on that, on collaborating with artists across the ocean, right? And not being able to jam in the same room.
Great question.
Right?
Let me tell you something. Let me build on that real quick. The magic happens with you being in the same room with whoever it is, whether it's a musician or artist or songwriter, whoever. I understand you're in Chile and you want to, you know, work with somebody in France or in the States or Chicago, whatever, so it's difficult. But there's ways now that you could actually work online together at the same time. I would say try that first, opposed to trying to send files back and forth, because you never get that vibe, that connection. You know what I'm saying?
Have you had the experience of getting a track done with remote?
Oh yeah, definitely. I get records done all the time, but the vocals are never the way I hear them that they should be. The parts are never the way that you hear them in your head. You know what I'm saying? So it's difficult. But sometimes, you know, when somebody's in Africa, you know what I mean, and you're 30 hours away, it's just difficult. But I would try to do the session at the same time so you guys can chat, you can see each other, you can actually collaborate at the same time, which was unheard of in my time, which is amazing that you can do that today. And I think that's what you should try to do.
I've got a question to follow up on that. A lot of the kind of iconic remixes you did for huge pop stars, was there much like discussion and interaction with them, or is it just like they give you the stems and you get on and do it?
Well, before stems, there was a 24 track tape, okay, analog tape that we used to get, and we put that in the studio. A lot of the times we would request the artist come into the studio and re-vocal for us, and that's how we began a lot of relationships and stuff like that. But then there were certain artists that couldn't come because they were on tour or whatever, and then we would just sample their vocal. But we preferred them to come in.
And re-vocalize the whole thing?
Yeah.
To change the tempo?
Why not?
This is pre...
Because think about it. A lot of the remixes that we were doing were probably 90 beats per minute, 95 beats per minute. They were soul records.
And you make it 120.
And they wanted a dance record, 122. There was no time stretching like this back then, okay? We used to have this big machine, like this big. It was like $9,000, and it would take you 3 days to time stretch a lead vocal. 3 days, where now you could just do it like this, you know what I mean? So,
come here and re-sing it. Come on, this is gonna, I don't want to spend 3 days.
Word.
Thank you for answering my question.
Thank you.
I got a gift, if I can give it to you afterwards.
Nice.
All right, that's what's up, man. Thank you.
Hi. Can we get the, have you got a question?
Yes.
Yeah?
So I was wondering if maybe you could share with us some of your more technical knowledge on your tracks. Mm-hmm. I know that it's maybe something that would take a lot of while, but for example, in your hip hop track, maybe you could explain the decisions behind some of your EQs or compression.
Well, I'm gonna tell you this. One of the things I learned early in my career was commit. Commit. Don't ever second guess what's going on. You know what I'm saying? Like, play it, and either you like it or you don't. You know what I'm saying? Like you're either gonna start over or you're gonna keep going. So commit, that's the first thing. So when you commit, you're able to build on that. You know what I'm saying? If you're a little confused and you're like, I don't know, it's hard to commit. The other thing is when I have the approach, and I've always stayed this way, is when I start something, I record it. Because the feeling you have initially, you're not gonna get back again. A lot of people take the approach where they make a beat, they put it away. Oh, I wanna come back to it a month later or whatever. Nah, finish the beat, finish the song, mix it, track it out, and keep it moving. Part of your question was the process. Years ago, I don't know why I'm getting that ringing, but years ago, I had to EQ my drum sounds into the drum machine so it sounded good when it came out of the drum machine. You know what I'm saying? So that was a process in itself, which today is the same mentality. You know, you have remember, your chain and your process is your sound. So your turntable has a sound, your mixer has a sound, your whole chain, whatever you're going through. So you have to make sure that you pick the right stuff that you like for your sound. You know what I mean? And something to this day that's, to me, doesn't sound, this is a mixer that I used to use. It's called the GLI 9000 and had a 5-band EQ on it. But those 5 bands, you could work wonders with those 5 bands. Because the bottom, you could take it out completely. And the mids, and I would bring up the high end for the hi-hats. I would bring up the mids for the snare drums. I would take the highs down and the mids down and bring up the bass for the kick drums. And that's how I EQ'd my sounds into my SP-1200. Because I didn't want the engineer at the studio EQing my drums. I just didn't want it. You know, we used to fight all the time. You know what I mean? To the point where it got down to it where I started recording all my drums on one track. So they couldn't touch it. You know what I mean? So the process, it goes on. You know, samples with filters. We could go on and on with this technical stuff. But the main thing is committing. That's the main thing is say, you know what? I like this. Let me go and finish it. You know?
Are you finding you're getting the same effect with the plugins you're using in Pro Tools or Ableton the equipment you were using back then?
I got this machine about 8 days ago, literally. It's been out for a while, but I just got it. And this brings me back to my childhood when I was 18 and 19 years old. Because basically everything that I needed 8 machines for, I could do in here alone.
Dope. Well, he's already got the mic. He's putting his hand up. He's already ready.
There's something I really want to ask. Hi. As Spanish speaking, I always loved about your tracks that you have like pregones, like chants, like Latin chants and like other kinds of chants. Uh-huh. And I wanted to ask you if those chants were like made in the parties, like while dancing, like people, did they scream that chants or were they like part of your cultural baggage? So you put them into the tracks?
You know a record that I did called ¿Qué lo que pasa aquí? ¿Ah? That's my dad. Yeah, rest in peace. That's my dad and my boy Mike Delgado and another friend of mine called Tony. And that happened, I lived in Brooklyn at the time, and we did that record for Todd. It's called Zoom Sight Say, and the name of the group is House of Gypsies. And it was just, we were on the steps of my house, and they were talking shit, you know what I mean? And that line came out. Man, I ran upstairs and I came back with a recorder. I'm like, yo, say that again. You know what I mean? And then we just, you know, I put the beat to it and did the drums to it. But the other part of your question, as a kid, there was a lot of Latin music in my house, you know, because I'm Puerto Rican. So my dad played this music every weekend for like 10 hours a day. Saturday and Sunday drove me crazy. Because, you know, I'm a kid, I'm, you know, 10 years old, whatever. I don't want to hear this, you know what I mean? Fucking horns blaring, going crazy, you know what I mean? I want to hear hip hop, you know? But later on, it's crazy because, you know, the more I got into music and the production of music, I understood what he was playing. And he was playing it for a reason. You know what I mean? So it could be embedded in me. But the chance comes from those Latin music, those Latin records and those African records. You know what I mean? That's where they come from.
Crazy. Well, right next to you.
Hi, how are you?
What's up?
I'm good. I wanted to ask you something similar to what my friend asked. What was like the ecosystem like in terms of the producers, the parties, the DJs? When you were starting up, that you feel that made your music successful. Like, what was happening back then that worked? What were the parties working like? What was the relationship between the producers and the DJs and whatnot?
Friendly competition.
Yeah.
It was like we were outdoing each other. You know what I mean? It was like, oh, he did that. I'm gonna do this. You know what I mean? And that's what kept happening back and forth. You know, but for a moment, like, me and Louis had this chemistry that was just, like, unstoppable. And it still is, actually, because we just DJed in Italy, and it was crazy. But in a studio, it's like I could not see this man for, like, 6 months. We go in the studio, and we make records. It's just, I don't know how they happen. It just happens. But it's you know, we push forward. And, you know, Todd had his sound, you know, you know, CNC Music Factory had they sound. David Cole, rest in peace, he amazing keyboard player. And it was us, and then it was Dave Morales, and it was Frankie Knuckles, and everybody was just doing their thing. And then Detroit had their thing happening, Kevin Sonneson and Derek May. And then Chicago had their sound. So it was like New York was like a melting pot of all of that, plus the disco too, you know what I mean? And the Latin. So it was just like we had all this stuff to feed that was feeding us that we didn't even know was feeding us, but it was. But that's basically what it, you know, how we went at it, you know.
How are we doing for time? And have we got time for more questions? I can't, if anyone can shout at me from up top. I totally lost track of time.
Peace, man.
Well, I'm just gonna keep letting people answer questions until someone stops me. So this guy. Right, sorry.
Hi, I'm very happy that you stay here in Chile. I'm very pleased. Actually, are two questions, but I related about the in these 28 years, they changed a lot of the way to play the music. About the technology, how was your change from the analog things to the computers in these years, and how you choose these sounds, because in Ableton you have 100 million of sounds. It's like, God, what I do with all this?
Yeah. And the thing with sounds, the things with sounds is, you know, everybody has the same sounds. You know what I mean? But at the end of the day, is what you put, what you use those sounds and how you use those sounds. I've always been into technology. I've always been into, I'm a gearhead, you know, and all my friends are. So anything new that comes out, we was always getting and jumping into. I remember the first time somebody told me about something called email. I was like, what the hell is that?
Taking it back.
Yeah, exactly, in my building. And where we had our studio, you know, there was a floor, a social floor underneath. They wanted our floor. And I was like, nah. And they were like, yo, they're like doing emails now. And I'm like, what is an email? Like, you know what I mean? And I also remember the first time somebody brought in a way to play the record digital. And it was like, it was something Scratch. Serato. It wasn't Serato. It was way before Serato. It was called something Scratch. And I thought this guy was out of his mind. I'm like, I'm never gonna stop playing vinyl. You know what I mean? And then, you know, slowly it transitioned. So, you know, you have to be able to be open to certain things. To that side of it, I was like, nah, I'm not messing with that. And on Serato, I'm on it late. You know what I'm saying?
But, you use Serato now?
Yeah, I use Serato. You know, but no, it just, you just take it in and you just kind of adapt. You got to keep adapting to the situation. You know what I mean? But also when you're traveling, you know, you want to be, you know, you be able to make music on the road too. Like now in this computer, there's probably about, with plugins and everything, there's probably about $200,000 worth of stuff in there if I had to connect that in 1995 in here now, which is crazy to me, where you can move around with a laptop and have the plugins to these original and they sound good. The emulations of, you know, these old pieces of these old compressors and EQs and, you know, especially with like dealing with the UA stuff is crazy. You know, those plugins sound amazing. So you can really, really get into it with this.
Do you think for the culture it's been a positive thing, or do you kind of actually think it's too easy now for people to?
Oh no, it's easy. It's easy. But at the same time, it's all upon what's up here.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? So whatever you put into it, you're gonna get out. You know, you can hear it. You can hear a record that was, you know, that people just took loops of somebody else and just, you know, copy and pasted, and you know, you could tell, you know.
Right, let's do one more question. So,
that, hey,
my man up here. Hi.
Okay, hey. People just grabbing the mic, guys.
Hi, Kenny.
I can't control this anymore.
Hey, what up, Kenny?
What's up?
Hey, man, what's up? There is a song that I love from BKD, This Beat Is Mine, which also was remixed by Wiz Khalifa and Snoop Dogg, but you did it recently this year, and it was amazing. I was wondering, how did you did it? How did you get that track, the funky bass? I was amazed.
What was crazy is that bass is on the original record. So I had the multi-tracks of that. So I got the master, and I actually mixed it from the master, but the drums are my drums.
Wow.
And then just, yeah. But the bass line is from the song that I took from a piece of the song.
That's amazing.
And that's a good question, because dealing with the technology and being able to mix and have sections of a song isolated brings out other pieces of the record that you wouldn't hear that was buried. They might have had strings, they might have had horns, keyboards, clavinets over that bass section. But when you're able to strip it down, and you know, it becomes this whole little funk thing, you know what I mean?
Appears the mic.
Yeah.
Thank you very much, Kenny.
You're welcome, bro.
You've probably been very lucky, because you've seen like the stems of like iconic artists, you know, and maybe seen their work process. You know, many people.
Yeah, you learn from
your remix catalog is
absolutely
Michael Jackson, like, and you know, Madonna, and you know, all these.
Absolutely, when you get those sessions, you You see how certain things were recorded and tracked out, you know, and you see how many tracks they did on claps. I'm like,
layering, you mean?
No, I'm just like 12 tracks of claps. I'm like, really? Yeah, but that's what gave it the sound. You know what I mean? And they're live claps, so somebody was clapping there for 10 minutes and did 12 tracks of that. You know what I mean? Like, it's crazy. But yeah, it's cool.
Amazing. I think we're going to have to wrap up. Thanks so much for...
Thank you. Chili. Word.
BUDx.
We got one more question. Santiago. Let's get him.
Okay, right. This guy, he's right really here. Keen. Let's get this guy again.
Hi, Kenny.
What's up, bro?
Welcome to the South of the South.
I know, man.
There is a kind of a specific question about...
Okay. This better be a really good question.
Yeah. Yeah. Absolutely.
Like,
yeah, because it's related with the Latin American background.
I got you.
Because you told us about when you listen the tracks of your father,
yep,
in the radio when,
yep,
when you grew up when yep you was a child, and but specifically in your career, when you be aware of your Latin American culture, intellectual Latin American culture.
It happened probably when Tito Puente came to the studio.
Ah, okay. That's an important thing. Yeah.
You know, actually a little before that, because the way we met Tito, we actually did a remix for him of this song called Rancancan. Yeah, so when we did that record, I was like, wow, and Tito saw the talent of what we were doing. He understood what we were doing in the studio. You know what I mean? So that was crazy. And then when I met Eddie Palmieri was the next step. I'm like, wow, this guy is like classically, the piano was bananas what he was playing, you know? But that time, like around 90, I would probably say about 95, 96.
Yeah, but
that's when it settled in that I was like, wow, like, I gotta incorporate this into what I'm doing.
In the intellectual way,
yeah,
you know, to produce music,
yep,
aware of the Latin American, yep, background.
Yep.
Okay.
Yeah.
Thank you.
You're welcome, bro.
I think that is a good question given that we're in Santiago, Chile. So thank you, BUDx Santiago. Thanks to you guys. Thanks to Kenny Doe.
Yeah. Yeah. And thank you, Akai, for sending this over. Thank you to Boiler Room. Thank you, Chili. And peace to everyone out there.
Let's party now.
All right, later.